Well, navigating sibling dynamics in the care for a relative can get very tricky. Families are complicated. Even families who get along beautifully can be very complicated. And illness, death, these are big, big things. And they tend to, at least in my experience, exacerbate family dynamics. Yes, families often come together around death or around illness, around big moments, for sure. And that is often the goal. But sometimes along the way, it can provoke sibling rivalries and old dynamics. And so one thing is just to be prepared for that. That's normal. This is a stressful situation and it shows. From a sort of a Western point of view, we default to the patient point of view, and absent the patient telling us their point of view or their opinion of what should happen, it will go to the durable power of attorney, which is often a sibling or often a family member, a healthcare proxy who will make decisions on behalf of that person. So this is sort of the Western legal ethics around complex decision-making. But we know there are cultural overlays and personal overlays. And so depending on the family, it may be appropriate to default to speaking to the eldest child or whatever else. But from my role as a palliative care physician, as an Anglo-Caucasian palliative care physician coming from the American sort of Western role, again, I'll start with the patient. If they can't tell me, then I'll go to whoever the healthcare proxy is, and then everyone else from there.
兄弟姐妹呢，在照顾家人的时候呢，意见不一样，其实是很常见的，也很正常的。那我们的建议呢是，要有合理的期待。那每一个子女呢，他们虽然出生于同样一个家庭，每一个子女都有自己的负担和责任，有自己的时间，还有金钱上的能力和压力。 健康上的能力和压力，所以呢，很自然的，他们能够每一个子女能够提供的协助呢也不一样。我们曾经呢有几个例子呢是，家庭呢他们分工合作的方式呢，就是他们呢决定呢把家人呢轮流一个月住一个子女家，那轮流这样住，让家人呢可以这个负担这个照顾的责任。 那这样子呢，虽然看起来是很公平，但是呢，对患者来讲，不见得是最适当的安排，因为这个患者是个失智症的患者。那在适应呢每一个家庭、每一个月都要适应一个新的环境呢，是对这个患者呢是有极大的压力，所以这样的安排呢，也不见得是最适合的安排。
严重的疾病还有重大的决定，都会构成家庭的危机了。 当中会掺杂着很多不同的复杂的情绪，比方说应该怎么样对于应对这个危机，家庭成员不一样，他们的反应也会很不一样。比方说是在家里照顾亲人呢，还是送到疗养院？在家里如果照顾亲人的话，需不需要请护理呢？那费用够不够呢？从哪里支付这些费用呢？ 面对一个非常严重的疾病，走到生命的尽头，精神上、情绪上、经济上，还有个人的工作上、个人家庭都各种压力下面呢，这些兄弟姐妹之间很容易产生摩擦和分歧了。那么怎么样处理呢？我觉得首先要搞清楚摩擦背后有什么原因，为什么他的意见和你不同，并且用尊重的一个这样的态度去回应。 那家人才能彼此之间达成一个谅解了，那么了解他人的感受是真的是很不容易的，但是需要很多的忍耐，也需要很多的同理心，同时呢，也是考验一个人面对危机的时候他的能力。一家人可以尽早的去坐下来，不要等到最后，要早一些坐下来。 将好处、将难处、将所有的问题都摆在台面上，能够很坦白的去表达，而且需要一个谦卑的去聆听，彼此聆听，听不光是听家人的意见，还需要听护士和医生。 他们的意见。病人他在不同的时间，他的感受就不同。他早上可以对儿子说，我没有疼痛啊，还好了。到晚上可能对女儿说，我很痛啊。那么造成儿女之间对于用药物方面的分歧。所以家庭每一个兄弟姐妹要彼此聆听，也要听一些专业人士的一些报告，这样我想会减少一些冲突。
我同意，就是家庭会议呢，其实是一个很有效的方式，可以让所有的兄弟姐妹呢能够了解，病人呢他的健康状况是什么，那了解就是说他病人需要的照顾是什么，然后呢可以就是讨论如何兄弟之间姐妹之间可以如何分工来照顾病人。
And I'll just add, I love what you're both saying. You know, from my point of view, it's very helpful for everybody to be heard. Illness doesn't just happen to a person. It happens to a family. It happens to a community. And so I think it's a very important notion that everyone has a chance to speak and a chance to be heard. And so often, at least from my point of view, there isn't a right or a wrong way to proceed. There are medical choices to be made, all sorts of choices to be made. And that comes down to very often a personal opinion, the patient's opinion, the family's opinion. So without a clear right or wrong way to proceed, that often means it comes down to a family working it out together. What's right for the family? What's right for that person? And that just takes a lot of communication. And with so much emotion in this, around this subject matter. And even if two family members disagree on the way to proceed, at least they can feel heard. And this is a very important way to avoid regret down the road.
我们在实际的访问的家庭当中看到很多这样的情况。远远的不在病人面前的子女呢，或者他们有他们自己的一些见解了，或者是照顾的想法了。我想最好就是家人在一起讨论的时候，不要一个一个这样子对病人，而是兄弟姐妹一起。现在 Zoom 是很方便，可以用 Zoom 大家一起坐下来，互相交流一下，看一看大家的意见怎么样。然后呢，我觉得这是一个非常好的一个沟通的方法。其实很多家庭的矛盾的冲突，就是因为大家听到的或者是感觉到的是不一样，所以就从个人的角度去选择一个治疗的方式。其实如果能够大家兄弟姐妹坐在一起，互相的去交流，看一看你为什么这样想呢？我是这样考虑的。那这样大家的沟通就会减少很多的误会，而且呢，如果有医生和医护人员能够参与这些 Zoom 是最好的。有一个权威可以去询问。另外呢，大家都可以想自己的方式，自己的意见放在一起，就产生就是减少很多的误会，是这样子。